and continue the description of the interaction of the radiation field with biomolecules. And we had derived that the radiation field adds a perturbation to the Hamiltonian for the molecule, and so that the Hamiltonian is then the Hamiltonian of the molecule without the radiation field, plus now the modes of the field, and we derive for them the form E over mass of the electron times an amplitude that was 8 pi n n1 divided by omega 1 and v, that's a photon density, and then we have U, the polarization vector, times P, the momentum, and e to the I k dot r, that's basically the operator. And since we want to calculate the real variable, a real observable, we have to take the real part of it. That means we have to take 1/2 of this mode plus 1/2 of the conjugate complex mode. But since the conjugate complex mode has a different time dependence, we can ignore it, as we will see sort of in a second. So this is our factor that we would call V1. And then we have e to the minus I omega 1 t, the time dependence, if we have a mode that is incoming. And if we have a second mode, I will not write it again, then we have here V2, same form, except the indices here are now 2. Here's the polarization of the mode 1. Here's also the k vector of the mode 1. Sorry, now it's hopefully correct. And then here we have now e to the minus I omega 2 t, or maybe if it's an incoming wave, sorry, if it's an outgoing wave that carries away energy, then it's plus. And so we might have more terms. And which term is actually successfully interacting with the molecule depends on what energy the molecule can absorb. And so that we see when we write the absorption rate for this radiation. And the formula is the famous Fermi's golden rule. And we have then this times n v1 0 squared times delta of epsilon n minus epsilon 0 minus h bar omega. So this is energy conservation corresponding to only absorption being possible where the energies add up like this. And then we have a similar term for the second mode that might also be ready to be absorbed. And that would look like this, times delta. Now we have a different energy formula. That would be epsilon n minus epsilon 0 plus minus or plus h bar omega. And so if we have minus, we have the same situation as here, except now for H-bar omega 2, and if we have a plus sign, then the energy is actually being taken from the system, and then we would have a situation that epsilon 0 has to be higher than epsilon n, and then we would have this one in case of the plus sign there. And we can have more modes. Each of the modes have their own delta function. So in order to get this correct with the delta function, actually, I have to multiply the argument here by h bar, and I need a normalization, so I have to put here an h bar, I think. So the people who make the notes, please watch out for it, that there should be an h bar. Okay, so this is how it looks like, and now we have a pretty straightforward situation. We have on one side energy has to be conserved. A molecule might be capable of absorbing certain energies, and those are then dictating this delta function, which is just energy conservation. Given that the energy of a photon is h bar omega, a photon cannot give a fraction of its energy. It can only give it in terms of quanta h bar omega. And then here we're getting then the term that determines the strength of the absorption. And that's what we want to look at a little bit more carefully now. And so let's now look what this is. And so I just now focus on this term here. And if I write it, then I find that this prefactor is 2 pi over h bar times e over me times the square root of 2 pi because of the 1/2 factor n1 divided by omega 1 v times h bar. And now we have the polarization u1, and then we have here our matrix element, and the matrix element is p times e to the I k dot r and 0, and so these are the state of the molecule that we are going to describe today also. And then when we realize that e to the ik dot r can be expanded like 1 plus, and this is very small because the k is 2 pi over the wavelength of optical absorption, of optical radiation, is between 4,000 and 8,000 angstrom. And the molecule that absorbs this radiation are actually just a few angstrom. And so there is then this a factor here that starts linear with an order of magnitude 1 over 1,000. And so it's a small contribution. So we can approximate it by 1. And we don't have the term then, and then we can simplify the calculation, replacing this whole thing here by a simpler form, namely by n, by r, and by 0, times m e times omega 1. Divided by I, but I doesn't matter. And so this is this is sort of what goes into the formula. And now we have then realized that the quantity that is really telling us with what efficiency we absorb radiation is called the transition dipole moment. And that tells us now, beside that energy has to be conserved in the act of absorption, this quantity tells us how good the molecule is in absorbing radiation. The transition dipole moment has to be large. Okay, so if we now put this all together, and we just take now one term, we say all the molecule just supports this energy conservation, this delta function is zero, we cannot absorb that second type of photon energy, then we are getting an formula that looks like this. Now this is all, you got some real service here, the teaching assistants or postdocs in this case, actually they wrote notes for you that are an excerpt of these big quantum notes that I gave you the first time round. So they contain only the key formulas that you actually need for describing the molecule to interaction with the radiation field. So it's really a very, very nice text that really just gives you the absolute necessary information. So if we put it all together, then we are getting the following expression, 4 pi squared times e squared times n 1 omega 1 divided by the volume in which we have the radiation, and then times u dot n r 0 squared times now the delta function. I don't write it out. So this is these are the quantities that determine how much radiation is being observed by absorbed by a particular molecule. The radiation with a certain polarization, and so the polarization has to have a component parallel to the transition dipole moment of the molecule. And the other one is just a prefactor full of physical constants and geometrical properties and the density of the photon. Okay, now we assume now what you call thermal radiation. So that's a radiation we have in this room, where we do not have an experimentalist who prepared particular type of radiation through, for example, zapping a laser with a certain polarization through the room, but rather we just get sort of like the radiation from the light bulbs. Then we represent all directions of K. Maybe I call it now the unit vector K, the direction in which the radiation can go, and U, the polarization that has to be always orthogonal to the K. We are the all equally likely, and you do that correctly, and it's done in the big notes. If you want to look at how it is, how this is derived, so you have to be careful that you don't overcount. U has to be always perpendicular to K, but you can do that, and then you are getting a formula for what we call the total absorption coefficient, where any radiation geometry-wise that just fits the energy conservation, so the magnitude of K has to be chosen appropriately, but the direction of K and U can be anything. And if you do this, then you can actually sum it all up and come up with some numerical factors that are 1.37 times, so just to take only 3 significant digits, times 10 to the 9, 1 over second, times A0 over lambda, the wavelength of the light, times 0, or n r 0 squared, die Viper Lambda-Task wird. So we, the energy correlation is also integrated over. So we just say, okay, we have all nearby energies, we integrate over the delta function, becomes one then. And so this is then our formula. Here we have the Bohr radius, A0 is equal to the cheat here, h bar squared over m e times e. And the wavelengths, sort of maybe important that I write it out for the biologists in the room, because we have to find out that we have to put in here the velocity of light to get the units, to get the normal units before we had c equal 1. That means that time and space have the same unit. That for physics is very good, but when you really want to calculate in terms of angstroms and size of molecules, then you want to use real wavelengths. So this is what we get. And now the wavelengths for optical absorption is, I told you this already, is 4,000 to 8,000 angstrom. So this is UV, the UV end, the blue end, and this is the red end. And now this A0 here is approximately, you know, this 0.5 angstrom. So this is about one angstrom. So we have 1 over 10 to the 3, a little bit bigger even. And here we have a few angstrom, not one, but maybe 5 angstrom, 7 angstrom for the typical molecules. And so that all together, that make this expression of the order of 10 to the minus 10. So they're all dimensionless. This is a length squared then. So it's 10 to the minus 10. And so the result is that that the absorption rate is about n, number of photons that you offer the system, times 1.37 times, or maybe I put that one equal one, times 10 to the 9, and 10 to the 9 I can write per second, I can write as 1 over nanosecond. And so times this jazz here, but if we are just sort of like typical molecule, we're getting 1 over nanosecond. That means that the absorption rate is 1 over nanosecond. So that is how long it typically takes to absorb radiation. Okay, now very important for a biologic organism is to keep that energy and not to fluoresce it away. And so it's also interesting to do now the reverse calculation and to find out what is the rate of emission. And we want to go immediately into the total emission, that to say we want the molecule is excited and it can emit any photon in any direction with any polarization possible in terms of the energy content. And then we find that we are getting actually the same formula, except here I write it first wrong. So keep a little space here because I have to correct it. And then we have 1.37. So basically the act of absorption is the same as the act of emission. It's symmetric. Not quite, as we will see. But this is a tendency. This describes the tendency to absorb, to emit light. And so now we see that looks like the emission is also 1 over nanosecond. So if a molecule has absorbed radiation, it will take about a nanosecond that it emits a radiation. And that would be no good in many cases, particularly for photosynthetic organisms. They want to keep the radiation. And so they have to do anything with the radiation energy faster than a nanosecond. Otherwise it would go. But we have a little bit of a problem here. Namely, we have a puzzle. The puzzle is that if I put a molecule, excite it, and then I shut the door to the lab and turn off the light, the molecule will have a rate of zero, because I have no photon in the system, it's dark, and it will be excited forever. And that's not right. It's wrong. The reason is that we have neglected some physics. We made an error with the physics. And what we have neglected is that the radiation field is quantized. So we said before, yes, it comes in energy of units of h per omega. And so that entered into the delta functions. But that's not enough of a job you have to do. You have to do more to account for the quantization of the radiation field. Now it turns out that for the purposes of this class, we can correct it very easily. If we go then and really study quantum electrodynamics, the first thing we learn, and that's the only thing we need to know from the fancy series, that we have to replace n by n plus 1. That means that if we turn off the light, we still have a 1 here. N is 0, but the 1 is still there. That means we can fluoresce. You call that spontaneous fluorescence. And that was postulated by Einstein, who said, you know, we have to have that, or there's a contradiction. Now, this gives rise to a very famous thought experiment that was actually also done in a real experiment, where you have an oven with thermal radiation. And let's say we have an oven with a temperature T. T might be not a very hot oven, not just like what is presently outside, but let's say 300 Kelvin. And so now we might have here a state 0 and a state 1 with the energy difference of h bar omega and the population of n1 and n0. Then we know that n0 to n1, we know is e to the h bar omega divided by kbt. So if h bar omega is the energy difference, then according to the Boltzmann distribution, the population ratio is given by this equation. So now we also know that we are getting absorption and emission. So this absorption has a rate which is it is how many states we have there and zero, that is how many molecules are waiting. Then here we have our photon number. So here we have n photons, n per volume, but let's say I call the volume 1. We have that many photons. And then we have a factor A, which is all this stuff here, that we just call A. And it's the same for absorption and emission. And so then for absorption, we have this is a rate, and the emission rate is n1 times n plus 1 times A. So same, except we have the n plus 1. And now in equilibrium, they should be the same. In equilibrium, so we have then that n0 NA is equal to N1 N plus 1 A. So we divide up immediately A, we put the N1 to the other side, and we are getting then N0 over N1 equal E to the H bar omega over KBT is equal to, and then I bring this one over here, n plus 1 over n. And now I put the n over here, n times e to the h bar omega divided by kBT is equal to n plus 1. I put the n to the other side and I'm getting n times e to the h bar omega divided by kBT minus 1 is equal 1. And then I getting n is equal to 1 over e to the h bar omega divided by kBT minus 1. And this is a very famous law, that is a Planck radiation law. That is the first sign of the quantum radiation field, and that comes from the factor from the n plus 1 that I invented here, that brings about this radiation law. So that's why we have the n plus 1 there. Okay, so we learned now how we can calculate absorption for particular radiation that has a certain polarization. We can also calculate it for thermal radiation that have any kind of direction coming from anywhere with any kind of polarization. We did the same for emission, and we got the formulas all the same except one time n plus 1. And so now we know how to calculate these rates. But we are still little bit puzzled by the key property, the transition dipole moment. And so that is what really is a property that evolution employed to make the biomolecules particularly capable of absorbing radiation. So they want to make this geometrical factor good, and also the biomolecules must bring the energy that they can absorb into the energy of optical radiation. So here we gave the wavelengths. If I put here the EV, then this one is about 3 EV, and this one is about 1.5 EV. Now if you have a hydrogen atom, or a carbon atom, or a nitrogen atom, or oxygen atom, this is what biomolecules are made of. The individual molecules have absorption energies of 10 EV, 20 EV. So they're much higher. So they are no any good for absorbing optical solar radiation. So they needed to design molecules that fit energy-wise, and then they also wanted to design them that they are giving a good transition dipole moment. And that's what we want to understand now. So now we must look at the molecules. Biomolecules that interact with light. They typically interact with light, so there are many of them. And I will, of course, just take one example, and I will take the easiest example. So the easy example is a molecule that is called carotene, or carotenoid, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I might have miscounted one of these guys, but then forgive me. And OK, okay, now I have to add here a few of these this guy looks like I even counted right. Each of these vertices is a C atom. So every time I have a vertex, there is a C atom. And I don't show the hydrogens. So they are only made of carbons. And of the hydrogens I don't show. I show you the hydrogen in a second, but at this moment I just show you. So this is beta-carotene, very famous molecule that is used by many plants to absorb sunlight, absorb the sunlight more in the middle of the spectrum and towards the blue, whereas chlorophylls absorb more towards the red. And it's a very good absorber. And if we take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this one here, this molecule here is actually also called vitamin A. Or retinal, and that is a molecule that we use in our own eyes to absorb optical radiation. And so we will talk about it next time, but so it's actually very close to us. And all animals with eyesight, with very, very, very little exception, have actually this molecule. And so it's sort of like a real good invention. It works very well. It's extremely sensitive. So we want to look at the molecule, but you know, this is a little big thing. We take a small case, and I begin first with a molecule which is sort of the smallest of this kind, and it's a molecule that is drawn like this. It's called acetylene. So it's actually a little bit different from this one. And acetylene is made of two hydrogens. They add a 1s electron to the system. And of a carbon molecules, they add 6 electrons to the system. One is 2R1s molecules. So they are, we spin up and spin down in the lowest state of the carbon atom. And then the remaining ones are 2s and 2px, 2py, and 2pz. So 4, and each of them 4. And now in case of this acetylene, the carbons have their orbitals. If this one is a carbon, here's the other carbon. They have their orbitals, one like this, and the one of the 2p like this, and then they have one of the 2p. So this one is a 2p in this direction, then have a 2p in this direction, a 2p in this direction. Let's call this one here 2px. Here this one we call 2py, and this one we call 2pz. That's how they do it. Now these guys here, however, the 1s and the 2py behave differently. They do what quantum system love to do, they form linear combination of states. And so they really, these two go and follow, they take a 1s, a 2s, plus a 2p, py, or they take a 2s minus 2py, of course, each of them properly normalized. And when they do that, you can find that they can make them the following orbitals. They can make an orbital, if you do this one, then you're getting actually this kind of orbital. And with this one, you're getting this kind of orbital. So they can make an orbital. When they take this one, it reaches over to the right side. And this one, it reaches over to the left side. And they do both.
this orbital here contacts here. So let's call this one orbital 1, and this one, this one we call 2. Orbital 1 makes contact with this guy. So they reach, hold hands, the electron orbits that overlap, and that is energetically more favorable because this electron here does not only see the carbon center here, it also sees the carbon center there, so it has 2 points of attraction. This guy is not so well off, but not too bad, because this is where the hydrogen comes. This is the 1s of the hydrogen. So the 1s of the hydrogen overlaps here, and lowers it, and here the other carbon. So you call this one the sp hybrid. So basically you make out of one p and 1s orbital, in both cases 2, so the main quantum number here, 2s and 2p, you make a hybrid orbital. There you can reach one over there, you can reach one over there. Okay, so that is trick number one. And then the molecule looks like this. If we make this one here, becomes a little messy here because they don't give us color in physics. So maybe I just show some of these orbitals, not all of them, not the one to the hydrogen. These are the orbitals, and then we have one orbital like this, and then we have also one orbital like this. And so we have one 2pz orbital, one 2px orbital. So one electron is in this orbital, one is in this. Same here, one is here, one is here. And then we have these handshaking orbitals, sp2 orbitals. Okay, so that is number one. Now, if we go then to another molecule called acetylene, then we have the same trick, except now we are adding more hydrogens to the system. The acetylene is actually a pretty energy-rich molecule. It's explosive. Can use it for when you are doing welding. You burn acetylene, and so it gives you a lot of energy. The next one, acetylene, is something that you can use for car engines, not quite directly, but indirectly. And that's this molecule. You have a carbon. Maybe I draw it a little bit more in the middle here. And now we have here a hydrogen, and we have a hydrogen. So each of the carbon gets 2 hydrogens. And here they connect with each other. And here we have 120 degrees, and same here. So now we have to make a handshake along this three directions, the threefold center. And you can do this, but what you need for this one is, if this one is the x, and this one is the y-axis, and you can do that with the 2s orbital and with 2p orbitals, namely the orbital 2px and 2py. If you mix them symmetrically, then you can make one handshake in this direction, looks sort of like this. You can make one handshake in this direction, looks like this. You can make one in this direction, looks like this. And they do the same. And now you have a molecule. There we had the molecule acetylene HCCH. Now we have the molecule H2CCH2. Here we have used up for the carbons 1s squared. So the 1s is here too. And then here, 3 orbitals, one handshake here, one handshake there, one handshake here. There's a 4th orbital missing, because the carbon has 6 electrons. Those are pointing in the d direction. And so if I draw this molecule in a plane, then this is a carbon, carbon, hydrogen, 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 hydrogen. And I draw this not to be complete, but because this is the most important electron for us. That one goes up and then here down, up, and then here down. And this one would be then 2pz orbital electrons, and they are really very important, as we will see in a second. Okay, so now we have, this is actually our molecule. These molecules have, they are making the system that absorb light. How we do that? 1 second. But now, of course, you can go a little further. If you know a little chemistry, you guessed it already. And you can make a molecule that is called H3CCH3. That is ethane. And then molecule has a carbon center, and at each carbon center it has a tetrahedron associated with it. So I draw now a tetrahedron, except that I will have to draw this carbon a little later again, so I draw here a tetrahedron. Draw maybe this one here, I dot. Okay, the carbon is at the center of this tetrahedron. So maybe here, it has a pointer here, a pointer here, a pointer here, a pointer here. And these handshakes in the direction of the tetrahedron, you can make with orbitals 2s, 2p, you need all of them, 2p3. The x, the y, the z, if you mix them with the 2s, you can make handshakes. And now you put in here another carbon, and now you're putting here likewise a tetrahedron, except I cannot draw too well here, but you have here a second tetrahedron, and here you have an H, and an H. One handshake is to the C, and this C has an H, an H, and an H. And so you have now this, this, and that is how this works. But these molecules are not absorbing light because all the electrons are really too firmly bound, and their absorption energy is like 10 eV, and you cannot do much with it. The acetylenes are too combustive, they're too explosive, they're too dangerous, so those you don't want to play with. So the one in the middle, as often in life, is the one that works quite well. And so now we take our last example. And this also example you do at the homework set. And this is a molecule hexatriene. This is a little longer than ethylene. So we have a carbon, a carbon, a carbon, a carbon, a carbon, a carbon. And here we have an H, 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 and here we have an H, and here we have an H. Now imagine that the molecule is sort of in this plane. So think of it in the plane. And now each carbon has 3 handshakes. 1, 2, 3, just like in the case of the ethylene. So this is here 2s2p² hybridized, each of them the same. This one here, handshake the carbon, handshake the carbon, handshake the one hydrogen. So each of them have their 1s orbitals down in the basement, in the energy basement. They don't do nothing there, they just hang around close to the nucleus and have a lazy life. The other ones, they are involved in the bonding, these guys. And now we have the 2pz orbitals. And these orbitals are doing the job. They absorb the sunlight. And so now we want to see how they do it. And so the electrons do that because they are mobile. They are not just sitting there at a carbon, but in fact they move around and they move around. And so they move around. And they have if we look at the Hamiltonian of these, and we have an Hamiltonian matrix that is a 6x6 matrix. We have here dimension 6 and dimension 6, because we have 6 electrons. They are moving pretty much independent of all the other electrons. And so we just can forget all about the other electrons. Of course, if you want to really do it well, we have to account for them. But here, for understanding, no. And so now we have here a metric that tells us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, good. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so. Okay, so this is how it looks like. And now we have here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here, this is our matrix. And on the diagonals, we have the energy of these electrons. And so this is epsilon zero is energy of 2pz carbon z equals 6 hydrogen type electron. Remember your quantum mechanics book where you talked about hydrogen type systems, and that where you find out what the energy is. Now, if they would be like this, it would be very boring. Oh, that's the same energy, nothing would happen. But the electrons can jump. The electrons can go from here to there or back, and there's an energy associated with it. The electrons are coupled to come here and go back. And this coupling is described by actually, it's usually called beta. Quantity that people call beta historically, so we also call it beta. And now they can also jump 2 or 3, but that's much smaller, and so the rest of it one can, in very good approximation, particularly for understanding the principle, say, okay, they're off. So this is how our electrons behave energetically. They sit on each side, but the side is coupled to the other side. The epsilon zero is about minus 11 eV, and the E and the beta is about minus 2.5 eV. Why negative? I don't want to explain. That's sort of like a heuristic number, but a pretty good number. So we will live with it. Okay, so this is this is how the electrons behave. And now these electrons with this kind of behavior described quantum mechanically, this Hamiltonian, is what absorbs sunlight. And if we go to related molecules like chlorophylls, we things are a little more complicated because we have a central atom, but basically it's the same story. Except that we have here, we have a linear molecule. In case of the chlorophyll, we have a ring molecule, but no, no big deal. Okay, so now how do these states look like? They're described by wave functions. And since we have six states, we can have six different wave functions. And the wave functions are written like vectors. And we call the first vector Cn1, second Cn2, Cn3, Cn4, Cn5, and Cn6. Six-dimensional vector, where n can go from 1 to 6. We have six states. Each state has six coefficients. And now we have this Hamiltonian. And if we multiply this Hamiltonian matrix by our wave function, this vector, we are getting En times psi n. And these are our stationary states of the individual electrons. This is the state they assume under stationary conditions. So we need to solve it. Now the solution is just a real typical problem in quantum physics would be like a perfect problem for example for the qualifying exam in quantum mechanics. So it's nothing really very special at all, and I solve it by guessing the right coefficients. And I write the coefficients as follows. I write them as Cnj is equal to, then there is a general amplitude that's the same for all the coefficients to normalize this state, times then sine pi j n over 2n plus 1. Now, if I choose now, so n goes from 1 to 6, j are my indices here. So this is here j. So this j goes here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. J labels atoms. N labels a state. J is atom. Now I begin to label not with atom 1, but with atom 0. Oh, that's not good, but if I put 0 in J equals 0, you see it gets signed 0. So with other words, the wave function will be 0 on the 0th atom. Now I have six atoms. I make this one here. I choose here, actually, this one is for 2n times 2n system. So the hexatrine is just 6, but you know, in general, we want to consider more. You might have 4, 6, 8. So we want to make it a variable. And so we have then 2n, and now 2n are my atoms, 1 to 2n. And now I go one further with j, then I have 2n plus 1 over 2n plus 1 cancels out, and I have then pi times n, sine pi n, also 0. So I can go to the 0th atom, and I can go to the 2n plus 1 atom. Every time I'm getting 0, so no damage done. Okay, now I take this description and put it in this equation. And now if you do this problem, you do it a few times, then you realize it's probably easy as long as you are in the middle of the matrix. But when you come to the edge, you have to be careful. Edge is different than, because here you have a beta, an epsilon, a beta, epsilon, beta, a beta, epsilon. But here you have only an epsilon, beta, no beta on this side. But because of my ingenious choice of making those amplitudes zero when they go to the outside, you don't have to worry about edge effects. And so we can just happily look what do we get in the middle of the matrix, and it's the same also on the edges. What do we get in the middle of the matrix? Now if you put in this one here and multiply this with the matrix, then we are getting 0, 0, 0, and then we're getting beta times an times sine, and then we're getting a j minus 1 times n times pi divided by 2n plus 1. So this is, you know, when I come here, this guy hits this one, hits this guy, the fourth one, and this one is one prior, and this one is one later, so this one is one prior hits the beta, the epsilon zero hits this guy, an sine j n pi over 2n plus 1, and then the next guy, one further, I only have three non-zero terms that multiply something with a coefficient. I'm getting here sine, and now I'm getting here one further, j plus 1, n pi over 2n plus 1. That's my left side here, matrix times this. That's how it looks like. And now on the right side, I'm getting en, an sine j pi j n pi over 2n plus 1. Okay, looks maybe not too good, but now we can realize that this one here can be written as, I use that famous formula, sine alpha plus minus beta is equal to sine alpha cosine beta plus cosine alpha sine beta, and here if I have a minus sign, I have to put a plus or minus sign there, depends on if I have plus or minus. Okay, so if I have this one here, then I'm getting for this one sine j n pi. This one is my, this one I make my alpha, and this one I make my beta. So this is j n pi over 2n plus 1 times cosine n pi over 2n plus 1. And then I'm getting this one plus cos sine. I don't write it because that will drop out, so I'm not bothered with it. You're getting the notes and it will be nicely derived there, but it's okay. So here I'm getting the same, except sine j n pi over 2n plus 1, and then here I'm getting here cosine pi n over 2n plus 1. But then I'm getting here minus, here I'm getting minus, here I made a mistake, sorry. And here I'm getting a plus, because this one is plus, so plus, and then I'm getting cosine and sine. And now what you will realize when you do this one, that these guys cancel each other, and you only keep these terms. These other ones are just exactly canceling each other. Now you also realize that the sine j can be factored out. And now what do we have? An can be factored out. An. Here was an an which I dropped, but okay, out. Okay, now I'm done. What I get now, if I read it now, I'm getting beta times cosine n pi over 2n plus 1 plus epsilon 0 is equal en. That's what I get. What? Did I make a mistake?
2 beta.
2 beta, you're right, you're totally right. Thank you. 2 beta, you're totally right. 2 beta. So that's what I get. So I got it. And now, okay. So now I can, I have now my energies for the individual electrons, and I can put them in, and if I draw if I the first one here, I have my ESJ, and you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The first one looks like this. 0 at 0, and 0 at here at 2n+1, but here in the middle, non-zero, and no node. That would be for n. So now this one would be what I'm plotting there is this expression here for n equal 1. And I vary j from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 is 0, 1 is 0. And so that's what I'm getting there. The next one, so each of the amplitudes is like this. The next one is has one note in the middle. So I'm getting here. Then something that looks like this. Again symmetric, and then I have here first 2 positive and then 2 negative components, and so on and so on. So all together I'm getting 6 energies. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now I put my electrons in there just the way I do it with hydrogen-like atoms, the famous German Aufbau principle, and the first electrons, the electrons filling up the first 3 states, one with a spin up, one with a spin down. And now if I want to excite one, I go here. And this one is a case for 2n equals 6 for the hexatriene. In general, I have here n, and here n states, altogether 2n states. So my first electrons are in the bottom n orbitals, and the top n orbitals are, you call those orbitals, like atomic orbitals, you call them molecular orbitals, but otherwise just the same thing. They're unoccupied, but when light comes, then you can lift them up. What's the energy difference? The energy difference is delta E is equal to 2 beta times cosine n+1 pi over 2n+1. Minus cosine n pi over 2n+1. So this is the n's orbital here. This is the n+1st orbital. And you know the lowest transition is from the highest occupied to the lowest unoccupied. That is the lowest transition, lowest energy. Okay, now you find in your favorite formula book that cosine A minus cosine B can be written as 2 sine A plus B over 2 times sine B minus A over 2. So I always make the mistake here, A minus B, but B minus A. I didn't make a mistake, so that's how it is. So let's calculate then the energy difference. And delta E, paper, you can check it, and if you don't believe it, check it out. And so now we are getting 2 beta times times this one here is this plus this. It's n plus 1 plus n is 2n plus 1 pi over 2n plus 1 is it's sine pi. Sine pi over 2, because here's over 2, a plus. So that's what it is. And now the other one is sine. Now this one minus this, is negative. And then I'm getting 1, of course, a pi over 2n plus 1. Okay, that's what I'm getting. Now beta is minus 2.5. So, and this one is 1, so I can write it as 2 times 2.5 is 5, so I write it as 5 eV times sine pi over 2n plus 1. So the signs are not right, this is a negative sign, positive. Okay, good, so now I say, not a good approximation, but not too bad. I just call sine x is equal x. I say pi over 2n plus 1. This is about 10, 12, 14, a pretty small number. So let's, what the heck, let's be generous and write this one as 5 eV times pi. I made a mistake. 2. I forgot over 2. So it's a mistake on my part. So pi over 2 over, yeah, maybe I write it like pi over 2 times 2n plus 1. Okay. Hope I get it all right. It's equal. Okay, this one gets, and now I want to compare this one with the energy of light, which is 1.5 to 3 eV. And I ask myself, how long does these these molecules have to be in order to absorb there? So now I hope I didn't make too many boo-boos here. So 5 times pi is 15. I made a mistake somewhere, right? You know what? I forgot this two. I forgot this two. So I have a two, I had a two here from the delta E. I had a two that I forgot two. You kindly told me. And here I forgot another two, so I had 4. So sorry, this was a 4. And now this one was in a 10. And now this the 2 becomes, okay, now everything is fine, I got worried. And so now what I do is I let me just do that quickly. This one times pi, we call it 30. Pi we just call 3, divided by 2 is 15. So I have here, I'm getting 15 eV, divide here. So this one is 1.5, of course. 3, okay, so then I'm getting bring this one over, and I have here 15 EV. I can divide out on both sides. So I have 15 divided by the very strange notation. Maybe I do it not quite too strange. 15 divided by 1.5. That's one limit, or the other limit is 15 divided by 3. That is equal to 2n plus 1. And so this one here is 10, and this one is, so basically 2n plus 1, so roughly 2n is roughly, that's the length of the molecule, is roughly 10. To 5, maybe 5 to 10. So that's the length of my molecule. And so And that is pretty good. So for the short molecules absorb in the blue, that's about the size of yeah, that's okay. And the redder molecules absorb in the according to 10. No, I'm a little bit off the real numbers are more like, I think the shortest one here is probably a little longer, you know, but I really played with numbers very loosely, but roughly you're getting the right order. So I think you know what I had pretty good. I just tell a little story and then maybe we have a few questions. So the story is that of the bullfrog. The bullfrog is an animal that sits like this in the water. So here's water. And it sits like this in the water. Here are the eyes. So if I show it from the side, then here's the water. Here's the eye of the bullfrog. And now you see that the retina of the bullfrog gets on the bottom light from the water, and from the top it gets light from the sky. So that is what the bullfrog is sitting all day. It sits there and has to be careful that it sees delicious things in the water, but if some kind of big fish comes, it swims away quickly, or it can see the stork who wants to eat it from the sky and wants to then also be careful. And so what this bullfrog has, it has a retina where the light receptors are, that is divided. On the top it has a molecule that looks like this. Where these two pi electrons go from here. And so it has 14 2pz electrons. Where on the bottom it has, just like the humans have, so this is where it looks into the normal sky, has this one, where it has 12 2pz orbitals. So it makes the molecule longer for the part that looks down, and the one that looks in the sky where it's blue, it makes it shorter. And that way it adapts itself to the circumstances. So if you ever seen a bullfrog, they really hang in the water the whole day, and that is what they do most of the time. And so that is what they have. Now salmon, however, when they come from the sea, they are living in deeper water, they have this kind of retina. But when they come then to the brackish water, where they turn their metabolism from salt water to sweet water, they are changing their retina to this one, so that they can avoid the bears that try to catch them and eat them as they go upriver. So you see that they really play very nicely by making things longer and shorter, and thereby adapt their systems to the prevalent radiation that is in their habitat. Okay, so.
So in building these six molecular orbitals, mm-hmm. you assumed that the electrons were all stuck in the same atomic orbital. Mm-hmm. Is there a reason why they can't excite to like a 3s state? Is that just outside of the range of energy we're looking at? Or the way they interplay with each other, does it make it even?
So we look at the lowest orbitals, and then the 3s don't mix in there. And we have this this energy, what you call the coupling energy. The coupling energy is very strong through the same orbital to the other side. But when you go to the 3s orbital, you have more nodes. So then the coupling washes out a little bit. It averages out. It's weaker. And it's energy up. So you, perturbation theory tells you can really couple well if your perturbation, the coupling energy, is larger than the energy difference where you want to couple. The best coupling you get when there's no energy difference. So this 2s, sorry, 2p. But 2p, 3s is energy uphill, and the coupling is smaller, and so it's much less mixing in. But the real reality is the following, that you can calculate these things today on computer very, very well, very accurately, the spectrum and the vibrations, but it's engineering. It's called quantum chemistry, and there are huge programs, and you don't want to know what's in there. And you know, you can calculate it, but it's not, I mean, it's physics, but it's also not physics. It's actually elegant physics, it's multi-electron physics, so we have fermions, you have to keep the anti-symmetric wave functions. They do that all well, but they do that since, you know, decades. And, you know, you take the program, you work with it, you have to be pretty good in quantum physics to use them, but it's more like quantum engineering than sort of science. So you have really good, and they would not, of course, they take 3s, they take 4s, they take everything near there, and they get things really accurately. The main problem is actually not so much that. The main problem that we neglected here is that the electrons interact with each other. Here I just was telling you, oh, we put the electrons there, and they each go independently, but no, they interact with each other. And that's actually a much bigger story, and as a result of this, actually, we luck out. The electrons have a very odd behavior. They are behaving according to two modes. One mode is dominated by the electrons trying to avoid each other. They interact with each other, they're so impressed by it that they try to avoid each other. That means they are standing more or less still where they are, and the only degrees of freedom left are their spins. So they basically do what you call a magnon. They flip spins up and down, and they move very, very little sidewise. And those are not modes that don't absorb radiation well, because the radiation comes with an electric field vector. It wants to kick the electrons to the side. You know, there comes this polarization vector, the electric field goes like this, and the best absorber is when the electrons are really being kicked to the side. But those magnetic modes, the electrons stand still, they're not impressed by radiation. Very difficult to excite them. Even though the energy would fit, it's very difficult. But the mode where the electrons say, ah, let's have a great party and mix with each other and run into each other all the time, let's not bother, that is another mode. You call those ionic states, where they are really bumping each other. They so often that you find often two electrons at the same atom, and then they have an extra negative charge. And those, they are, you know, like more, they act like independent particles, and that actually pretty well described, not really quantitatively, but qualitatively, how many states you get, which of the states absorb light very well, which don't do it so well. But that's a real story. Okay, good.
So you mentioned the emission rate, and the emission rate is proportional to the number of photon plus one, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But I cannot see why the number of photons appears here, because that means the more photons there are, the faster the emission. Oh.
Yeah, so that is a famous laser effect. You call that induced emission. So you can have spontaneous emission and induced emission. So that is a famous physics effect. You might have heard about it. And so you use it in a laser. You are generating sun in a laser photons. They fill then the laser tube, and then, as you see here, then the more photons there are, the more emission you get. They fill more and more and more, and you're getting a burst of laser light, and that you call induced emission. And the one with the one you call spontaneous emission. Okay, thank you.